Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. The picture tonight we have for Ezekiel 24 is very fitting, and I appreciate Rose Sanchez finding a picture of a pot and putting a fire around it. She did a good job, didn't she? The thing is here is that the city of Jerusalem needs to be purified. And God is going to use the nation of Babylon to be this instrument of cleansing for Judah, for Jerusalem, for Benjamin, for the cities of Jerusalem and Bethlehem and other cities around there. It's going to be a horrifying event. Now, in the midst of chapter 24, God's instructions to Ezekiel are very interesting in the sense that I don't know that any one of us, and as I studied this, I realized this is not something I think God could call me to do, because I'm fairly sure I would not be able to do what God calls Ezekiel to do. And it's something that cuts right at the very heart of really a very practical lesson of what it means to mourn over loss this evening in chapter 24. So we begin in chapter 24, verse 1, and here in the first two verses, Ezekiel is about to set the scene for the exact day, the very day that Nebuchadnezzar, hundreds of miles to the west, will attack the city of Jerusalem and lay a sword and fire to the pot of that city. He says, again in the ninth year, in the tenth month, on the tenth day of the month, the word of the Lord came to me saying. Now, he has set the scene. He's spoken of the year. He's spoken of the month. He's spoken of the day. Now, this is in a sense a bit prophetic, because the actual day doesn't occur till the end of the chapter. But God says to Ezekiel, listen, this is what I want you to say to the people in Babylon. They know that God has been prophesying through Ezekiel absolute destruction for Jerusalem. And in a sense, Ezekiel hasn't been clear or really been given a word by the Lord as to when that was going to happen. So perhaps they were thinking, well, maybe it's 100 or 200 years from now. Maybe someday soon, God will just forget about it, you know? His anger will go away and he'll just let us go back, and we'll be back to the old ways, won't we? God is going to say, I never forget, and my judgment is always perfect. The word of the Lord came to me in that ninth year, in the tenth month, in the tenth day, and he said, son of man, write down the name of the day. Write down this day. Now, can you imagine Ezekiel sitting in his home in Babylon, and God is saying, I want you to record this exact day in history. Now, Babylonians, the Chaldeans, kept very exact calendars. So, in fact, we know that this happened on January 15th in the year 588 BC. That's the exact day. Now, you may be wondering, well, that doesn't sound like the 10th day. Different months, okay? Different months. And Ezekiel is being told by the Lord, this is the day. As I'm giving you this prophecy, understand this. 300 to 400 miles west of you right now, Nebuchadnezzar is cresting the hills of Jerusalem and streaming down upon this city. But I don't want you to tell the people until we get to the end of this prophecy, because there's a very important lesson I'm going to live through you, Ezekiel. And you know, the interesting thing, sometimes the cost of ministry is huge. It really is. Sometimes the personal cost of being a prophet, of being a priest, a pastor, is huge. And we're about to see that it's going to be huge for Ezekiel. This very day, verse 2, the king of Babylon started his siege against Jerusalem this very day. So we're going to see in the next few verses that Jerusalem is going to be referred to as a rebellious city, a bloody city, that it's a city with pollution in its pot, a lot of scum. The scum is not only all over the outside of the pot, it's all over the inside of the pot. It's an unclean pot, and the uncleanliness of this pot is again based on a rather lengthy history of sexual perversion. Now, it is interesting that when idolatry is mentioned in the Old Testament, it is almost always mentioned exclusively or connected with sexual perversion, because many of the pagan deities and pagan religions were based on fertility gods and fertility rites. And a lot of that stuff is still practiced today. And God says, you know what, that's them, but I expect something different from you. I really do. He begins in verse 3 by saying, Ezekiel, utter a parable to the rebellious house and say to them, thus says the Lord God, put on a pot, set it on, and pour water into it. Gather some meat in it, good meat, the thigh, the shoulder, fill it with choice cuts. Take the choice of the flock, also pile fuel bones under it. Make it boil well, and let the cuts simmer in it. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, woe to the bloody city, to the pot whose scum is in it, and whose scum is not gone from it. Bring it out piece by piece, on which no lot has fallen. Now, in those days, there was a pecking order in the household with respect to who got the nicest pieces of meat out of the pot. In some households, a lot would be cast and to see who gets the first hook into the pot. That's what's being said here. No lot has fallen on this pot, for her blood is in her midst. She set it on the top of a rock. She did not pour it on the ground to cover it with dust, that it may raise up fury and take vengeance. I have set her blood on top of a rock, that it may not be covered. Jerusalem is like someone who's taken a filthy pot, filled it with water, choicest meats, as you see God describes, the choice of the flock. In reality, what God is describing is a city with choice people in it. The best of the people, perhaps the best of Israel, have all come and they're residing in the capital city of Israel, a major city prior to Nebuchadnezzar destroying it. In the days succeeding the wealth and expanse of Solomon's kingdom, many of the kings after that pilfered and just used money, and the kingdom began to shrink. The kingdom got smaller, and more idolatrous pagan gods came into the nation. And it sinned. It continued to sin. It continued to follow the idolatries rather than the heart of the living God, to the point where the temple became rather run down, filled with weeds, a time when nobody really went to the temple at all. The priests were, you know, bivocational. They'd mow lawns during the day maybe, or clean pools or something, work at Starbucks, and then they'd go back to the temple and they'd work. That was never intended to be that way. And the end result was people's hearts began to wander and forget the living God that placed them there. To the point that people would just stay home and worship the little idols in the niches of their households. God said, I put the finest of the people in this city, and they're about to be boiled together with the filth of this city. And rather than Jerusalem seeing, oh my goodness, what's happened here, the pot is filthy, the stuff inside the pot has become filthy by cooking it all together. We need to dump this. We need to bury this somewhere. We need to cleanse the pot and start over again. Let's start church the way it used to be. Let's get back to the old time religion. Let's have a revival. Let's have a cleansing. Let's have a purifying. Let's have a time when people fall on their faces before God and make it right. That's what God wanted. But note, please, that God said, you're a bloody city. She did not pour it out on the ground and cover it with dust. She put it on the top of a rock. She lifted the filth even to the top of Mount Moriah, even to the top of the Temple Mound. And she seemed to be proud of her filth, of her stinky mess, of her ugliness and smell that nobody cared for. Therefore, verse 9, thus says the Lord God, woe to the bloody city. I too will make a great fire. Heap on the wood, kindle the fire, cook the meat even more. Throw in some spices, let the cuts begin to be burned up. Then set the pot empty on the coals, that it may become hot and its bronze may burn, that its filthiness may be melted in it, that its scum may be consumed. Now that word filthiness, of course, is almost primarily something that is connected to a perverse sexuality. But it is interesting that this scum that's been mentioned over and over again is something that God wants to burn out of the very DNA of Jerusalem. He wants it so gone, so obliterated, that you would think this kind of scum or filthiness or lewdness we saw in chapter 23 would never happen again in the city of Jerusalem. And I have to say here real quickly that I have met way too many Christians who've had revival moments, true repentful moments. And as Peter describes, like dogs returning to their vomit, they lap it right up. And I wonder, what's so attractive about the vomit of old? What's so wonderful in memory about the ancient days that you're attracted to leave the holiness and glory of God's presence and go back and wallow with the pigs again? And yet it happens over and over and over again. Jerusalem has grown weary with lies, and her great scum has not gone from her. Let her scum be in the fire. I've asked the question of Christians when they've come to me and said, you know, I just can't understand why this happened to me. And my response oftentimes is a question to them. Just how far do you believe that a loving God would go to recaptivate your heart, to turn you back toward home? Just how far would a loving God go, even if you must limp the rest of your life, but you will limp to the altar over and over, glorifying God for what he has done because he has brought your heart back home. And we look back and we see that God was in every portion of it. And we knew that a loving God was in fact willing to do anything necessary to push us along the way. So we major in God's graciousness. We don't minor in our failures and catastrophes. We focus on how God has been so gracious over the years. Challenges at home, challenges at church, challenges in a life that no sane person really should ever choose. That would be the clergy. Only to know that God had a plan. Does Ezekiel know that at this point? I'm venturing that he knows it to a degree, for there he is, hundreds of miles from his real home. He knows God has described his city and his temple being leveled to the ground, agonizing for a priest who Ezekiel is. And then as God begins to talk to him about Ezekiel's coming example, I can only imagine Ezekiel attempting to swallow that walnut in his dry throat. I, the Lord, verse 14, have spoken it. It shall come to pass, and I will do it. I will not hold back, nor will I spare, nor will I relent. According to your ways and according to your deeds, they will judge you, says the Lord God. Ezekiel is not Jerusalem. What he's saying to Ezekiel is, Ezekiel, listen, I have said this concerning Jerusalem, but to this point, I personally believe that he's also told Ezekiel, here's what's going to happen in your life. And friend, it's not because you're Jerusalem, but because you're going to be a godly example of the response that I want for my people when they see that which they love destroyed in front of them. And the word of the Lord came to me in verse 15. And God said, Son of man, behold, I take away from you the desire of your eyes with a single stroke. And I tell you, you shall neither mourn, you shall not weep, never shall your tears run down your cheek. I command you, sigh in silence. Make no mourning for the dead. Bind your turban on your head and put your sandals on your feet. Do not cover your lips and do not eat man's bread of sorrow. And so Ezekiel said, I spoke this to the people in the morning. And that evening, my wife died. Was God judging Ezekiel's wife? There is nothing in Scripture for us to presume that she was any figure or form of the city of Jerusalem. It appears that God's method in this is not twisted, is not perverse, it's not insensitive and uncaring for Ezekiel, but rather demanding from Ezekiel a manner and a form of ministry that is all-encompassing. What I'm saying to you, Ezekiel, is this: that what you are going to pastor these people with is an example that will cut you to the quick. It will take away from you the desire of your eyes with a single stroke, your wife will be dead when you get home. And here's what I command you to do in spite of the loss of your wife. And it's interesting that verse 17 is almost a perfect picture of what mourning the loss of someone in the household would look like for a Jewish family. They would not sigh in silence. They would cry at the top of their lungs. In fact, many Jewish families would hire mourners to walk through the streets and bring the whole city to a place of mourning at the loss of someone perhaps they don't know, but in the midst of that mourning, professional criers are taking people to an emotional place where they empathize, they sympathize, their hearts break. But you will sigh in silence. There'll be no mourning for the dead. A man's mourning for his wife was something that was really pretty formulaic. He was told that he would cut his robe. He might even cut himself. He would bear in exposition the pain of his loss. He might shave his head. He might even cut his head. He might shave his beard or cut a portion of his cheek in the removal of that beard so that people seeing him would know, oh my goodness, this man loved his wife. What else could he do? But in the agony of her loss, harm himself. Bind your turban upon your head. In the morning of a loss, you would wear your clothes disheveled and cut and your turban undone. So it would be obvious that you are in mourning. You would not wear shoes. He says, put your shoes on. Don't cover your lips. Expose your lips. And the reason they would cover their lips is because they would be quivering with weeping. And special bread of sorrow, bitter bread. But I did as I was commanded. And the people said to me, will you not tell us what these things mean to us? Will you not tell us why you're behaving so strangely in the loss of your wife? In other words, what's wrong with you? Your wife just died. What's wrong with you? And I answered them and said, it's the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord came to me. And he said, behold, I will profane my sanctuary. Your arrogant boast, the desire of your eyes, the delight of your soul, and your sons and your daughters whom you left behind, they shall all die by the sword. Now, who's not going to cry? And the problem was, they didn't care. And Ezekiel's example was of a person that didn't care. This is what God was saying. You shall do as I have done. You shall not cover your lips nor eat men's bread of sorrow. Your turban shall be on your heads, your sandals on your feet. You shall neither mourn nor weep, but you shall pine away in your iniquities and mourn for your sins with one another. Thus Ezekiel is assigned to you. According to all that he has done, you shall do. And when this comes, you shall know that I am the Lord God. When what comes? When the word comes back to Babylon that it was this day, this very day, it was just as Ezekiel said that Nebuchadnezzar cut the temple to the ground and cut their sons and daughters and burned them to the ground. Will it not be in the day when I take from them their stronghold, their joy, their glory? Verse 25. The desire of their eyes, that on which they have set their minds, their sons and their daughters. On that day, one who escapes will come to you and let you hear it with your ears. And on that day, your mouth will be open to him who has escaped. You shall speak and no longer be mute, and thus you will be a sign to them. And they shall know that I am the Lord. What God is saying is this. I am the God from the burning bush who spoke to Moses and said, I am that I am. 70 times in Ezekiel, God says through Ezekiel, I'm saying to this so that you know, I am the Lord God, Yahweh. I am that I am. I'm the great God Almighty. And I do what I see right to do. And if you remain in your sins and you lap up the vomit and you refuse to clean the pot, friends, this is personal now. God will take even the pot down. I don't know if he has to go as far as he did with me. That only says how deep of a need in my life I needed God to really reset my balance. I don't know if he'll need to throw you in a ravine in India. I hope not. But have you wondered lately, what is God doing? I say this to you, I know what God's doing. He is loving us into obedience. Loving us into obedience. If you will not respond to his glory, to his power, to his careful, loving faithfulness and gentleness, Romans chapter 2, verse 4, all leading us to repentance, if you will not repent, I'll take it up a notch. Oh, you won't repent at that notch. I'll take it up another notch. What does God want? He wants a broken and contrite vessel fit for the master's use. What does he need to do to get you there? I don't know, but I'm just telling you what God had to do to get Lucy and I, or more importantly, me there. I'm telling you what God did for Ezekiel for the sake of his ministry. I would say the best response tonight would be to repent right now. Wouldn't you say that? Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in his spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.